From the colossal factories and yards of the post-war world to our fragmented, insecure, modern working lives, this is a history of the way we have worked. It's a story of epic change.
In the last seven decades, we've seen how work has changed from being just what you do to who you are.
In my own family, we've built ships and sold groceries, worked in the typing pool and on the factory floor. My grandmother put the walnut on top of your walnut whip. But during the 60s and 70s, my family, like so many, found their working hours shadowed by conflict.
These were the years when our workplaces were divided between them and us, when work was a war zone.
You'll get as much as you are prepared to go out and take.
These years at work were not all quarrel and racket. They were also years of reward.
People wanted better standards of living, better standards of prosperity.
And years of ambition.
Do you like being a boss?
Oh, yes, regularly.
From the factory floor to the open plan office.
Our work got us the things our hearts desired. Are you being served a bit of sitcom slapstick silliness?
Put it down.
Shall I put that down?
No, I don't want that put down.
A bit of cheeky innuendo.
They'd have to pull the handle a lot of times before they got my cherries up.
And in 1975, a spasm of angry workplace strife.
Now I move that this meeting authorises me to put our demands before the management and the former strike committee with carte blanche to take industrial action. Hands up, all those for the motion.
A row over Mr. Granger's coffee break plunged Grace Brothers into turmoil. Another workplace in trouble, in an era in which no one's interests were being served.
We don't want promises, we want guarantees.
We've got two things to decide, what we want and how we are going to get it.
So we tell you, keep up the picketing. Donaldson can get stuck.
Henceforth, there is no point in us having meaningful discussions and the helpful exchange of views, then?
None whatever.
Then get stuck!
I could have been a sailor, could have been a cook.
But all this workplace belligerence had its roots in a moment of youthful energy and optimism. The post-war baby boom generation were all grown up. And the mid-60s saw them tumbling out of school and crossing into the world of work.
I could be here and now. I would be, I should be, but how?
Keith Ryan started his working life as an apprentice plumber in St. Helens in Lancashire.
It was the transition from being a schoolboy to actually joining the adult world. So, yeah, it was exciting. I can actually remember, yeah, very vividly the first day. New donkey jacket and a brand new pair of shiny black boots, so it was obvious I was a new lad. It was in the days when you were apprenticed, they had all sorts of initiation ceremonies. Well, I'm not sure whether they still do them because equal opportunities and the health and safety work out wouldn't allow it now, but a favourite one was to grab the apprentice, remove his trousers and put putty round his bits. I thought, why? I don't know, but it was part of the initiation ceremony, and Fortunately, it didn't happen to me, but our mate of mine was an apprentice joiner, did it to him, and he had to shave his pubic hairs off with his chisel to get rid of the putty before he went home. So there were all sort of things like that. It was a proper man's world, if you like.
...22-year-old Penny Hale was also working in something of a man's world. The only woman technician on a team building a great British techno dream. Concord.
I was working in an enormous hangar with draftsmen and engineering groups. I was solving differential equations manually, working out the temperature gain of the aircraft wings. It was exciting at the time, and you felt that there was going to be a lot of investment in the country. I mean, that's what we're very good at. Technology and inventing things.
In the mid-1960s, though, many of us were still actually making things. Almost 9 million of us put in a shift in manufacturing. As an experience, it was a long way from the frolics and freedoms of the so-called swinging 60s. Frank Carrigan joined a workforce several thousand strong as an apprentice in a Glasgow shipyard.
Did you want a job in the yard?
Yeah, foolishly I did, yeah. Yeah, I always aspired to be a tradesman in the yard.
And what sort of place was the yard when you went into it?
Frightening. Noise was horrendous. It was dark. It's just scary. Everything was very, very large and all of that.
It made a man of you, do you think?
Yeah, I hope so, yeah. I mean, to the extent that you learn that, you know, if you were straight with people, they'd be straight with you and they'd be fair with you.
It was quite a tough existence, but there was a camaraderie about it. I actually lost my wage packet. And they had a whip round on site because they knew I'd lost my money. And I ended up actually getting slightly more than I would have done if I'd kept my wage packet. It was that sort of supportive environment in many respects.
In these abundant years, another wage packet was always just around the corner. We were still in an era of full employment, where government thought its main job was to make sure we all had a job. Charles Handy was a young executive at Shell Oil in the 1960s.
The Employment Society was a society in which basically, you move from institution to institution. You move from school to university or some kind of training establishment into an employment organisation, public sector or private sector.
Oh, yeah, there was... There always seemed to be work. You were young anyway, your life stretched ahead of you, so there were always opportunities, depending on what you wanted to do.
Oh, good morning, Terry.
Mr. Maitland's a youth employment officer. He'll fix me up, no trouble. Well, he always has done before.
You want me to fix you up again?
Well, you always have done before.
Reach into the magic top hat and produce a nice, easy, healthy job, about 30 quid a week, no special skill required.
Just what I'm looking for.
Yeah, me too.
They made sure you had money, and basically they were a social mechanism for guaranteeing that everybody had a livelihood. And it was a wonderful, convenient way for the state to run society.
This is in the London Evening Standards. Pages and pages and pages of jobs. A steward butler is required for a director's dining room in Mayfair. A cashier required for a group of companies in Barking in Essex. A film company requires a junior typist. Unilever Limited are looking for an estimator and production engineer. There's an advert here headlined, "Are you 34, 24, 36? Attractive model receptionist typist required. Please call Mr. Stern."
Hello.
In that buoyant late 60s moment, when it seemed old limits on your lifestyle were breaking down, young Brits had their pick of a rich job market.
Hilary Morgan, a nursery nurse, Ronald Venables, a trainee chef, Carol Johnson, a production worker in a biscuit factory, and then there's you.
In 1967, the BBC asked 19-year-old Essex boy Lionel Took to sample life at work. On the itinerary was some time in the Ebbw-Vale Steelworks in Wales. For a nice young man from down south, it was a bit of an eye-opener.
It was something that was straight out of a Victorian industrial nightmare. I just found it completely dangerous, and it was. You can see from the film, they're not wearing any safety kit, no helmets, no safety jackets. You know, they're wandering around the place in their shirt sleeves and flat caps. They probably thought it was wussy to wear a helmet.
What did you make of the men?
I found them very hard, crusty, quite bitter, really. Working in the steel mill was a grim experience that they did for the cash. I think it was to do with feeling kind of left out of sort of mainstream civilized development and so on, and that they were left to do the dirty work, and people thought badly of them, despite doing the dirty work.
Imagine in my sleep and in my dreams that I'd climb this mountain and I would get to the top and I'd say, I'm going out, I want to get out. And there this huge barbed wire fence would be there. Get back down to that valley and stay there.
6 a.m. and that Monday morning feeling settles like a deep depression over Iceland.
The truth was that in the grown-up world of work, you could choose your job, but it was a lot harder to control your daily working life.
This is the most essential work what we're doing in a modern civilization. Somebody's got to do it.
This wrapping machine needs an operator to stop it if a fault develops. It's not a particularly interesting job.
What exactly is that you've just made?
Chocoblob, Abrati.
How long did it take you to make it?
About a minute.
And then you do another one?
Then I do another one.
And another one?
And another. And another.
You are at the mercy of the shift and schedule of industry.
Now what you do, you put four of the little boxes into one of the big boxes, see? And then you stack all the big boxes over there.
Don't you get bored?
Of course I get bored, I'm going off me nut.
40 05.
Well, how many years have you been making that particular shock absorber?
About 7 years, up and on.
Exactly the same pattern.
Exactly the same.
I worked for 3 months in a place like that.
It's like something out of Kafka.
Yeah, well, it's not for me, babe.
Sidney Bricknell was a young father of 4 kids working on the line for a company making components for car production in Shropshire.
How long does it take you to complete the job you're doing? And then you do the same thing again every 3 minutes.
Yes, this is a repetitive job.
The first thing that occurs to me is you look just like James Dean, but what occurs to you when you're watching that? What were you thinking?
When I look back on that, I was very reflective then, and I didn't seem as though I was bothered, but it was a very mundane life, a mundane job.
Well, I clock it at 7:30, and I think, well, I'm not a human again until I clock out at 4:30. I go out to my jig, put my clothing, protective clothing on, put my mask on. I'm shut away then. You like being marooned in the centre of a town. There's a lot of people around you, but you're alone.
You're like robots.
Yeah.
Well, that's it. It's like Groundhog Day. The same thing every minute of every hour. Every day, especially if you're working 7 days a week, which is, if you wanted to make the money, you had to work as much overtime as you could.
Even though I don't like
like it, I'm prepared to accept that I don't like it for the standard of living that I can obtain from the job. And then one day you find 10 years
have got behind you. No one told you. You don't have to be a professor of economics to realise that many things are badly wrong in Britain today.
Many of us might just have been working for that weekly wage packet. But when it came to our productivity, how much we made or did day by day, we were slipping way behind our industrial competitors. The way we worked was part of a corrosive cycle of economic headaches, including a shocking balance of trade crisis. But from deepest Surrey, could this be the answer to our prayers?
In 1967, a bunch of office girls from Surbiton, no less, decided that they would boost the country's balance of trade by offering to work for an extra half day without looking for any extra pay.
It just seemed a really good idea. We just thought of the whole population working half an hour for free would just fix things.
This gesture mushroomed into a campaign, and before we knew it, Britain was festooned with Union Jack posters and badges proclaiming, "I'm backing Britain."
And thousands did back Britain, doing their 30 minutes free for GB PLC.
You started your extra half hour's duty on Monday. What is your own company to show for it?
Well, the extra productivity within our organisation is of the order of 6 or 7%.
We were very young, quite insignificant working-class girls. We didn't expect it to take off like it did, but I am proud of that just very ordinary people sometimes have a voice.
And it wasn't just ordinary people adding their voice. In January 1968, the campaign was given an anthem. Step Up, Mr. Bruce Forsyth.
I'm back in Britain, yes, I'm back in Britain. We're all back in Britain today. The feeling is growing, so let's keep it going. The good times are blowing our way. Holidays in Blackpool, plenty of fun. Buy a British car and look for the sun.
Did you enjoy that? Just to be clear, Bruce's words of wisdom were, "I'm backing Britain, we're all backing Britain, the feeling is growing, so let's keep it going, the good times are flowing our way." Didn't he do well?
But not quite well enough. Like many British innovations, the campaign briefly flowered, faded, and was forgotten.
You doing an extra half hour, sir?
No, never done it. No, don't believe in it.
The late 60s would be remembered for many things. A surge in productivity is not one of them.
Telling us to back Britain, end restrictive practices, work harder, and everything will be all right. They must think we're stupid.
But this grim British failure to make our workplaces vibrant hubs of productivity wasn't restricted to the shop floor. Meet the British boss class. It was widely accepted that British management in the late 60s and early 70s was not the natural home of fresh, dynamic thinking.
The main problem, to my mind, is the inability of management to manage men properly.
I think part of the problem of business, actually, was that we trained our businessmen as accountants. Accountants, as you know, don't like risk. They look backwards, not forwards. They're not very good with people.
I have two problems. First of all, that I have a lot of regular things that come up and that have to be fitted in because I'm an accountant.
So it was probably a disastrous preparation for the world of business.
From Europe came gentle suggestions that maybe the habitual bowler hat wearing of the British city gent reflected a certain stuffiness.
The West German economics minister has said that British businessmen who wear bowlers tend to be rather too traditional in their business methods. Would you agree?
I don't think so. I think they've got a damned impertinence to make any suggestions that we're not as efficient as they are.
Look, you said the British businessmen who wear bowler hats are...
What the hell's it to do with you? Get her!
Oh, dear. Bad hat day. A rather shocking survey by Management Today magazine in 1970 showed that only about 10% of British bosses had any formal qualification at all in management.
We're always hearing about it, if not from the government, then from industry itself, the need for better management education.
The good old British tradition of muddling along and making do was no way for dynamic modern management to power ahead. What was needed were new ways of thinking and new ways of teaching.
Charles Handy had left Shell Oil and was invited to help start the London Business School, an attempt to infuse British management with intellectual rigour.
Approximately 20% of the appropriate homes have followed up and bought it, but you're not suggesting on an overall...
First, he had to steep himself in the American way of teaching business.
Businessmen can be trained. They're not just born.
It totally dominated my thinking, and we were trying to bring that experience across the Atlantic. A business school in those days, in England, it meant commerce, it meant typing, it meant, you know, it certainly didn't mean management. The concept was totally alien. Management was thought to be rather like making love, you know. You should be able to do that, you know. If you can't do that, you're pathetic, you know. You certainly don't go on courses on lovemaking, and you shouldn't have to go on courses on management.
Part of Charles's job at the brand spanking new business school was to give a stirring motivational introduction to new students. Anne Tasker heard him speak when she attended the school in the early 70s.
You assemble in this lecture theatre, and this man appears, who's the director of the programme, and gives you this amazing, inspirational talk about all being eagles and soaring to the heights of the business world.
Business school experience was and still is very exciting. I mean, it's a wonderful intellectual voyage of discovery.
It was very exciting for us all, and I noticed by the end of the first term that people had adopted and started to use terms like ratios and regression analysis and high beta strategies.
So that he has got a net profit position, in a sense. It's kind of derived, I suppose it's a derived demand curve.
So it was almost like being a member of a club.
Now, the particular problem we're concerned with here is that of a company which is considering manufacturing.
Management was acquiring sharp thinking and sharp elbows. And this was a little distressing to those comfortable with the conventional certainties of British business life.
This is part of John Betjeman's executive. I am a young executive. No cuffs than mine are cleaner. I have a slimline briefcase and I use the firm's Cortina. In every roadside hostelry from here to Burgess Hill, the maitre d'hotel all know me well and let me sign the bill. You ask me what it is I do. Well, actually, you know, I'm partly a liaison man and partly PRO. Essentially, I integrate the current export drive and basically, I'm viable from 10 o'clock till 5.
A new breed of managers was born, but the poisonous British blend of befuddled old bosses and stubborn staff had taken its toll.
No firm negotiates without the permit with a man of work! No firm! No!
Many of our workplaces were now dominated by discord, and labour disputes blossomed.
Hey, shop steward, I'm calling everyone out. Right, you're on strike. Stay well. Sit down.
Get up, get up. Come on.
Stay well.
Get up there.
Sit down.
Get up.
Sit down.
Get up.
Sit down.
Get up.
Sit down.
Get up.
In the mid-1960s, working days lost to strike action were bubbling along at the, 2 to 3 million mark. By 1970, that figure had risen to a staggering 10 million.
Don't you think, CJ, it would be a more valuable exercise if Arthur played the manager and Thruxton the worker?
How come?
Well, it would teach them about the them and us situation which bedevils British industry so tragically.
I didn't get where I am today learning about the them and us situation which bedevils British industries.
Managing the unions and dealing with the unions dominated everything.
Well, Pitt, what's the trouble?
Well, Governor Slardis, we feel we're falling behind vis-a-vis the workers in comparable industries.
Managers had lost control, actually.
We want deeds, not words, you see, otherwise we're coming out.
I will not yield to threats by a politically motivated scum!
I don't think my members would appreciate that nomenclature!
Well, that's what they are, isn't it? Marxist scum, writs under the handbags! I'll flush them out!
All right, we're all coming out, then!
You're all set!
Right, you bastard!
In the early years of the 70s, a new Tory administration had promised to bring some order back into the workplace. But they were faced with a generation of employees who were children of prosperous times, of years of full employment.
I don't believe that anybody in the trade union movement wins anything at all unless they're prepared to be militant.
They were no longer deferentially grateful to be in work. They had power in the workplace and were not afraid to use it.
You get as much as you are prepared to go out and take.
Richard Griffiths worked at an ICI plant in Birmingham and became active in the Electricians Union in the early 70s.
I've been on many a marches up and down the length and breadth of this country, and I've enjoyed it. There were a lot of camaraderie and comradeship in being in there. There was a drive forward to have better working conditions, better working rights for the individual. They have done a lot of good for a lot of people.
This union-led drive for better and more meant your workplace could be hit by a dispute about anything from pay or conditions to closed shops, differentials, or demarcation. Your working week might be slashed to 3 days, and your workplace might be plunged into a dimly lit age.
Who do you think wins with these strikes, usually?
Well, the strikers.
How does a strike begin? What might happen?
You just got a troublemaker who decides to be different from others and just goes on strike and everybody follows him.
So the strikers win, do they?
Most times.
Do you think there's anything wrong with these strikes?
No.
When confronted with union muscle, the Conservative government of Edward Heath was rattled.
My grandfather used to work here at one of the shipyards on the Clyde. That was way back in the 1930s. He was a riveter. I remember when I was growing up, occasionally my grandmother would refer to the rallies that she would take all the kids to, the Red Clydesider rallies that would happen in the parks in and around Glasgow. And it would seem that by 1972, that spirit of radicalism had come alive again.
UCS was a consortium of shipyards on the Clyde, welded together by government in a desperate attempt to rationalise an industry, toiling against competition from Europe and the Far East, which had better equipment and more flexible labour. But the plan had failed, and in the early 70s, UCS faced liquidation.
What was the problem?
The problem was that they intended to close the yards, basically. They intended to reduce it substantially, and it could have been the end of shipbuilding in the Upper Clydes totally.
Sammy Barr had worked in the shipyards for 25 years, and as a shop steward was at the heart of the trades union reaction to this crisis.
All the shop stewards, we took a decision that we were going to fight to keep the shipyards on the Clyde, and the next movement was to have mass meetings in each of the yards.
We'll take the vote, brothers. For the shop steward's recommendation, could we have a show of hands? Shout aye, brothers.
The workers in the yards, though, didn't down tools in protest. They upped tools in defiance. When the liquidators came to close the yards, they locked the gates, occupied the sites, and kept on working on the orders. Fronting the work-in was eloquent communist shop steward Jimmy Reed.
There will be no hooliganism. There will be no vandalism. There will be no babying.
The management supported us, and we came together as a one movement that we all wanted to save the shipyards on the Clyde.
We asked to give us guarantees as regards the future of the UCS workers and the UCS itself.
They even had a message of support from Lennon. John Lennon, that is. He and Yoko sent a card with a big cash donation and a bunch of red roses. Their message reads, "Power to the people," with love from John and Yoko. The campaign to save the yards from commercial annihilation gathered momentum. Over to Martin Bell in Westminster.
And the shipyard workers did what they came to do. They carried their campaign to the streets of London, the Houses of Parliament, even to Downing Street itself.
We made it quite clear to them, we're here to fight and keep the shipyards open.
And soon after this meeting, the harangued Mr. Heath heeded their plea. His government conjured up a rescue package for UCS. Clydeside solidarity prevailed over commercial viability.
These are bulletins produced by shop stewards throughout the dispute to distribute to the workforce. And they're full of facts and figures, and it has to be said, quite a lot of rhetoric. But beyond that, they're promoting a much bigger philosophical idea. They say here, our fight is the right to work.
Brothers, I want to make this point. Everybody talks about rights. There's a basic elementary right that's involved here. That's our right to work.
Why did you have the right to work?
Well, we didn't always have the right to work. And it was something we aspired to, because there could be a payoff at the drop of a hat in the yards. And as soon as somebody coined the phrase, the right to work, it had a note with all of us. It was a residency for all of us.
The right to work. Today, it seems a rather quaint notion, wrapped in the misty idealism of working class unity, detached from profit and loss business reality. Sid Bricknell remembers the shop floor attitude to the company's fortunes in his factory.
They never saw the big picture. People weren't educated in whether the company needed to make a profit or not. They went there and they just saw their own little world. They'd go there, work, get paid for what they do. Whether the company made a profit or loss, I'm not going to say they wouldn't have been concerned about that.
Yeah.
But they weren't aware of it. They didn't see the big picture.
In 1972, Keith Ryan was trying to get a small building company going in North Wales.
I was ambitious. And certainly when I met my wife, she was ambitious for both of us, really.
He and his partner Mike were working on their first job fixing up two bungalows when the National Builders' Strike was called.
We'd heard about flying pickets and we thought we'd be okay, maybe they wouldn't spot us. And Mike said, oh, I've just seen somebody on a motorbike. I said, so what? I said, well, let's see. Within an hour, two cars arrived with eight blokes in. And they came across it, all right, lads, yeah, fine. What are you doing? Oh, just building a couple of bungalows. We'd taken on an apprentice by this time. We're trying to do things right. Well, do you know there's a national builders' strike? Yes, we are aware of it, but, you know, we've only been going about 5 weeks on this site and we've got an apprentice and we want to keep going. Well, we'd like you to join a strike. Well, we'd rather keep working. Well, if you don't join a strike, we'll set fire to your cabin and we'll be back, we'll wreck your mixer and we'll knock all your work down. And so we set down two lads and that was it. And it lasted over 5 weeks, and really, that took the edge off us, really. We were never the same after that.
Come on, brothers!
Industrial disruption even penetrated the pinnacle of British culture.
I must now advise you that I am in a position to consider a favourable offer. In the meantime...
No!
I beg your pardon, Miss Withering?
I'm sorry, Mr. Boggs, but I can't let you give up like this.
I've no alternative, my dear. 2 weeks of this strike has finished us.
Kenneth Williams, star of many a carry-on caper, dropped this curdled little aside into his diary in 1972. Oh, what a scourge and a blight is the English working man. What a dishonest, lazy bastard. Only exceeded by the Welsh and the Scots.
Dad, look!
I can't believe it. Coming back!
I had a feeling they would today.
Why today?
It's the annual works outing.
And in some real workplaces, things were obviously going almost comically wrong.
Here's a little tale that might strike a chord. My uncle told me that around about this period, when he was working in the print room of a Glasgow newspaper, one of his workmates would come in for his shift and happily clock in every night, only to fall asleep for 8 hours in the corner of the workroom, where he had, conveniently for this very purpose, installed a nice big comfy mattress.
The union versus management push, pull and punch up had left Britain battle scarred. The car industry seemed to sum up our plight. Shoddy goods and bad attitudes.
Absenteeism is high here, particularly on Mondays and Fridays. As a general rule, fewer cars get built then, and they're of poorer quality.
I don't know much about management, but you've got to work with them to believe them. I don't think they could run anything.
The way we worked seemed to say everything about what was wrong with Britain.
And this is a copy of the Wall Street Journal from April of 1975. In amongst all the articles detailing the comings and goings of Western capitalism is an editorial laying into the UK in the strongest terms, criticising its high spending, high inflation and high taxes. In conclusion, it says, "Goodbye, Great Britain. It was nice knowing you."
This diagnosis of demise and collapse was echoed by politicians, intellectuals, and talent show hosts.
Well, friends, it is the end of the show. Tomorrow is the end of the year. Let us work with all our might to see that 1975, with a gathering storm of despair ahead, will not be the end of our country. Let us all together say in 1975, both to the nation, to each other, and to ourselves, for God's sake, Britain, wake up!
But for some, amidst the downfall of the nation, opportunity knocks.
A foreman's job is one of the few chances for promotion off the line. Now bearded and bristling with authority, Sid Bricknell, once the top-paid welder, has got the foreman's job at last.
Where's Billy, lads? Press
with Toby. Well, I was so overjoyed at leaving that job. It's just like starting another life, being born again.
Sid, you were evangelical there. I feel like I've been born again. What was it about that job that made you flourish, that made you so happy?
It was a job with a future. It was a progression from the job I had before. The future opened up to me there because there was positions higher than mine that I aspired to.
Where will you end up, do you think?
Managing director.
You sound a wee bit cocky saying that.
Perhaps I do sound cocky, but I'm ambitious.
I wonder when you said there, you know, managing director, I mean, you had the nerve to say that on camera. Do you think there were people higher up who thought, hold on a minute, laddie?
That smirk.
Yeah.
That say, well, you know, he hasn't had the background because most of the chief executives, they had that posh public school talk.
Sure, I was down there, mate.
And I always had a strong feeling that why not?
Yeah.
You know, if I'd prepared to go the extra mile. But there didn't seem that interesting a company about me making any further progress for whatever reason, I don't know.
Sid never did become MD, but from his humble start welding parts, he did rise to be the senior foreman. His sparky ambition and desire to get on at work and in life would have impressed someone else rising to the top of their workplace.
We're the people that in the past made Great Britain the workshop of the world. Who can doubt that Britain can have a great future?
In 1975, Margaret Thatcher was a new Tory opposition leader with a new story to tell. Britain could be a great working nation again if we cast off the fetters of workplace warfare. And there was, of course, something else about Margaret Thatcher MP. She was a barrier-smashing, tradition-breaking, decision-making executive woman. Here are some facts from Britain in 1975. Whilst the majority of women were now in work, less than 2% of them were managers. Today, it's nearer 33%. In the mid-70s, Kay Millward was a mother, a wife, and a very unusual person.
Good evening.
Hello, Tim.
Dining in restaurants on an expense account is traditionally one of the perks enjoyed by a successful businessman, but today also by the businesswoman. Kay Millward is frequently entertained and entertains business clients. This meeting is to discuss a loan of £50,000.
I was brought up where the wife always had a meal on the table for her husband. She always did the washing. She always looked after him. He never went out unless he was clean and tidy. And all he did was work, bring home the money and sit down and have his tea.
Carol? Make a cup of tea.
It wasn't like this in the Millward household.
I've always been ambitious. It's never been enough to stay home.
Do you like being a boss?
Oh, yes. Revel in it.
Kay used to be, well, just like a, you know, normal housewife. And gradually, as she got little things to do herself, and I like to think that I gave her little jobs and helped to make her into what she's turning into now.
But hubby Norman wasn't always quite so comfortable with Kay's progress.
If the kids were particularly naughty, he would always say it was my fault because I wasn't there.
When Kay was a typist, fast cars belonged to the boss. Today, Kay's the boss.
I did have a new car every 2 years, and he resented that.
On the road, Kay found that business negotiations with men were peppered with incredulity.
Half of them didn't realise that I was sort of IC, you know, in charge, and they just assumed I worked there. If I would go all serious, and try and discuss what they wanted. They just thought it was a huge joke and that I couldn't possibly be serious.
Good evening. Tonight we're bringing you the programme we'd intended to transmit before Christmas, but couldn't because of the strike.
Anne Tasker started at Shell Oil armed with an MBA from the London Business School and dreams of executive achievement. It was not a dream shared by some of her male colleagues.
On day one, actually, the guy who'd recruited me said there has been some animosity in the department from one or two of the senior managers to having a female MBA, so keep your head down and keep quiet.
What did you think when he said that? I mean, you've presumably been working your tail off for 2 years to get your MBA.
I just thought, OK, I'll keep my head down and stay quiet.
Penny Hale was still working on the Concorde project, but she found the world of futuristic aerospace engineering struggling to cope with recent developments in women's ambitions.
As I stood up, I could see no women across the expanse of the warehouse, apart from the ones who were secretaries. We did go to Slough a couple of times with my boss, and he was asked why he was bringing his wife with him.
One of the things that was different for me from some of my male cohort, if you like, was you could see some of the senior managers almost socialising them into the roles that they were going to occupy in the future. Yeah. I know it sounds silly, but you'd go into the bar as a working group and the senior guy would buy the first round. And then it would be OK for the up-and-coming young men to buy the subsequent rounds. If you were a woman, it was not acceptable to buy a round. So if you tried to join in that group, they would be, no, it's all right, my dear. You know, you keep your purse in your handbag.
Overnight business trips with colleagues could also be a queasy experience.
If you went to a hotel, they winked and used to give me a bedroom right next to the boss, you know, and give you a sort of little wink to the receptionist, because they didn't believe, really, that you were an engineer.
But discrimination could be more cutting than a nudge and a wink. At Concorde, Penny Hale was working at a special cut-price ladies' rate.
It was set down that women were paid 80% of men's salaries. I was a bit annoyed, I must say, and I sat reading my newspaper and one of the managers went past and asked what I was doing. And I said, well, this is my 20% of the time that I'm not paid for. So I began to get a bit more frustrated then. For men who were taken on at the same time as myself, I found had been promoted to the next level. And when I went to the personnel officer and asked why that might be, and he said, well, you can't bang the table, you can't be aggressive, you can't go into meetings and impose your will on other people. And that was the time, I think that was the first time, really, that I realised that I was being discriminated against.
Deeply disenchanted, Penny left for a career in academic research. In lots of British workplaces, it was as if the new female lifestyle freedoms of the 60s and 70s had never happened.
In the 1960s, we saw new laws on homosexuality, on marriage and divorce and abortion. It was all about our private lives. In the 1970s, it was all about the workplace. There were acts on health and safety, equal pay, and sex discrimination. It was nothing less than a workplace revolution.
These acts were, of course, enthusiastically fought for by many working women, and more often than not, by the unions. But perhaps they had an unforeseen longer-term effect.
They were put in place with a view to protecting mass employees. But I think they actually worked over time to help people focus on their own individual relationship with their employer in a way that people... The legislation meant that people had to deal almost one-on-one with those issues like their contract of employment or their maternity leave or their grievance procedure or whatever.
But in the sun-kissed summer of 76, we were still in the age of mass industrial relations. The trade unions could claim to look after the interests of millions of working people and were at the apex of their power.
In 1976, an opinion poll showed that the majority of people thought the most important man in Britain wasn't the Prime Minister, it was Jack Jones, the leader of the Transport and General Workers Union.
There can be no escaping the fact that our great industrialized nation simply cannot do without trade unions.
Hello, little brothers and sisters. It's me, Jack in the Box Jones. Now, I was made at TUC headquarters, or as you prefer to call it, 10 Downing Street.
Union leaders worked hand in glove with the Labour government to make restless British workplaces relax. After 10 years of spiralling strife, in 1976, days lost to strikes collapsed to harmonious mid-1960s levels. And industries in trouble were given generous infusions of public money to keep their unionised staff in work, to the fury of a small businessman from Torquay.
I mean, if they don't like making cars, why don't they get themselves another bloody job designing cathedrals or composing violin concertos? The British Leyland Concerto in four movements, all of them slow, with a four-hour tea break in between. I'll tell you why. Because they're not interested in anything except lounging about in conveyor belts, stuffing themselves with my money.
The unions, it seemed, had found their place in the sun.
The years of dreadful marches had union members delighting in a decade of rising wages, on average about 15% a year, the kind of money that could fuel aspirations.
People wanted better standards of living, better standards of prosperity. The unions were there to support and help and make sure they got their just rewards for the job that they were doing. So, yes, it's about trade unions saying, you deserve a bit more.
How affluent are these people? Two out of three families have a washing machine and refrigerator. Four out of five have a vacuum cleaner. Nearly all have an electric iron.
But hey, this is Britain in the 1970s. The sun of glorious summer couldn't last. The ominous companions of industrial peace were financial instability, spending cuts, and climbing unemployment. In 1978, the clouds lowered, and our workplace woes dominated British life again. Brawny men huddled round braziers, and in that discontented winter, there was more productive effort lost to industrial action than at any time since the general strike of 1926. Through 1978 and 79, a spectacular 38 million working days were lost in the 4,500 disputes that flared up. Amidst all this rancor, celebrated poet Philip Larkin wrote a sour little letter to his old mate, Kingsley Amis.
Up to a century ago, he said, if you wanted more money, you just worked harder or longer or more cleverly. Now you stop work altogether. This is much nicer and anyone can do it. In fact, the lower class bastards can no more stop going on strike now than a laboratory rat with an electrode in its brain can stop jumping on a switch to give itself an orgasm.
University librarian Larkin was one very dapper but very acidic public sector worker.
Larkin wrote what he called a dreary little hymn. I want to see them starving, the so-called working class, their wages yearly halving, their women stewing grass.
Resolution of the strikes resulted in double-digit pay rises.
Well, we've got what we asked for, practically. What they offered us in first place.
A situation report after the winter of discontent might conclude that union power had prevailed again. Their membership was about to peak. 13 million of us were card-carrying brothers or sisters. And Britain felt like a place where we all knew where we belonged, with them or us.
I think that we are institutionalised as a nation, and that the union and being part of that nation is in itself institutionalised.
But down on the front line, that certainty about our working lives was starting to fall apart.
They were beginning to cut these huge workforces and unemployment was rising.
From the mid-60s to 1980, 2 million jobs were lost in manufacturing as great British industrial titans became remnants of another age.
There was no way that these organisations were going to continue as massive sort of entities on their own.
We were starting to work in different ways, in different jobs, entering an age in which all that was solid melted away.
It wasn't a lot of people in big organisations with jobs for life. Actually, it's much more fragile than that.
Ground floor perfumery, stationery and leather goods, wigs and haberdashery, kitchenware and food.
No story of 1970s Britain is complete without another sneaky little peek at Are You Being Served? You'll remember in 1975 there was that threat of the strike and the go slow. Well, in 1979, take a look for yourself.
You're late, Mr. Lucas.
Ah, yes, well, I had trouble getting through the cleaner's picket line. They were exercising their democratic rights to explain their just grievances. I said I was sympathetic, but I needed the lolly.
So what happened?
The leader of the picket line took out her lipstick and sent you all this message.
The days of solidarity were gone. Miss Brahms, Mrs. Slocum, Mr. Lucas, Mr. Humphreys were crossing their workmates' picket lines. Grace Brothers, like Great Britain, was a changing place.
We're fed up with stoppages everywhere. All we did was come to work and get on with the job.
Yes. I didn't fight in the desert to support endless strikes.
I bet those Germans are glad they lost. They'd be bankrupt by now.
Next time, through the agitated 1980s, the way we work brings freedom and satisfaction to plenty, but shame and hurt to many.
We've got Cricket World Cup highlights next on BBC Two, England's crucial last group game against the West Indies. And there's drama over on BBC Four now with a pioneering doctor protecting Manchester from the Spanish flu.